Well, ladies and gentlemen, you have heard both the special representative of the Secretary General, Mr. Lakhdar Ibrahimi, and the ambassador of the Federation of Russia speaking about the closed session of the Security Council, in which Mr. Ibrahimi announced his resignation. The Syrian government takes note of the decision of Mr. Ibrahimi to resign. And as you have all heard, Mr. Ibrahimi acknowledged himself that many mistakes were made during his tenure. That was a courageous move on his side. It came too late, unfortunately, but he stated that many mistakes were made during his tenure of 2 years. I'm in your hands.
كان هناك اليوم حديث لوران فابيوس وزير خارجية فرنسا قال لجون كيري وزير الخارجية الأمريكي أنه لو أن الولايات المتحدة قصفت سوريا في ذلك اليوم لكان التاريخ تغير. كيف تنظرون إلى مثل هذا التصريح؟ وهل فعلا كان التاريخ تغير في سوريا؟
أستطيع أن أؤكد لك بأن الجغرافيا السياسية ما يسمى بالجيوبوليتكس تغير، نعم، بفعل صمود الشعب السوري إزاء كل هذا الضغط من العديد من القوى العربية والإقليمية والدولية. نعم، الجيوبوليتيك تغير، سوريا هي التي غيرت الجيوبوليتيك، هذا صحيح. واحد. اثنين، تصريح وزير خارجية فرنسا بهذا الشكل هو تصريح غير مسؤول، لأنه يأتي من وزير خارجية دولة يفترض أنها عضو دائم في مجلس الأمن ومؤتمنة على الأمن، على الحفاظ على الأمن والسلم الدوليين، في حين أن هذا التصريح يدل بشكل منقطع النظير على أنه تصريح أهوج يدفع باتجاه استخدام القوة بدلا من استخدام حيثيات الميثاق ومبادئ القانون الدولي. على كل حال، يعني الوزير الخارجية الفرنسي سبق له أن أحرج نفسه في كثير من الظروف. إحدى المرات كان في مجلس الأمن بعد أن صوتنا على القرار 2139، وافق على القرار وصوت لصالحه، ثم أتى إليكم وتحدث إلى الإعلام بشكل يخالف تماما ما كان قد ورد في القرار 2139. فرنسا جزء من المشكلة، ليس جزء من الحل. السياسة الفرنسية سياسة متهورة، كانت متهورة تجاه ليبيا، متهورة تجاه مصر وتجاه سوريا وتجاه كل المنطقة. فهذه ليست أول مرة يخطئ فيها الفرنسيون في تحليلاتهم، ولحسن الحظ أن فابيوس قد قال هذا الكلام، لأنه يؤكد ما كنا قد ذهبنا وأشرنا إليه مرارا وتكرارا من أن فرنسا هي جزء من المشكلة وليس جزءا من الحل.
Mr. Brahimi did make regarding perhaps a mistake in his mind of the holding of the June 3rd presidential election. So what other mistakes are you indicating that he acknowledged perhaps he was responsible for? Thank you.
Well, I think we shouldn't blame him for all the mistakes. Of course, he made some of these mistakes. Others made the rest of the remaining part of the mistakes. The American administration made mistakes, the French government, the British, the European Union, Qatar, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, all of them made mistakes. And nowadays nobody could deny these corroborated facts about this accumulation of mistakes made by all these foreign powers. Of course, the main mistake was this interference by these foreign powers into the domestic affairs of the Syrian people. No wonder that the European media is speaking now about 10,000 European terrorists from Europe only fighting in Syria. No wonder that everybody knows nowadays and speaks about how deeply the Turkish government is involved in facilitating, sponsoring, and training the terrorists crossing our common border with Turkey in order to be able to come inside Syria. No wonder that the French Minister of Interior today spoke about 277 French terrorists fighting in Syria, while the Reuters agency is raising the figure up to 767. So these are figures, they speak for themselves. These governments made huge mistakes to the Syrian people as well as to Syria as a whole. And we will not be satisfied only with apologies. These people should be responsible for paying the compensation for all this bloodshed they caused in Syria.
The U.S. administration declared the Syrian opposition coalition a quote, foreign mission. I wanted to know, what effect do you think that has beyond, they said they could help them get a bank account, basically. And also, I wanted to ask one other thing
I will let you ask your other question. Actually, this is a very important point. It's really surprising to see some people in Washington making also other mistakes. For instance, the American administration policy now considers Boko Haram in Nigeria, I mean the kidnapping of the 200 girls, innocent girls, as a terrorist group, while they are helping the same people in Syria, and they call them armed moderate opposition. They are helping the terrorist groups in Syria, willingly or unwillingly, and they call them moderate opposition. But in Nigeria, they call them terrorists. The same terrorists in Syria kidnap girls and rape women, and they do exactly the same thing, and they abduct innocent people. So how come in Nigeria they are called terrorists, and in Syria they are called moderate opposition, to which Washington is providing, as you know, weapons and financial support, and political support, of course. The other part...
I don't know if you'll comment on this, but two of the names being circulated as possible replacements. One is the Tunisian former foreign minister of Ben Ali.
I think it's too early to speak about the alternatives to Mr. Ibrahimi. It's not at the table right now.
ماذا لو أن الانتخابات لم تحصل في الثالث من حزيران؟
هذه خطيئة أخرى للسيد الإبراهيمي وهو اعترف طبعا بمجموعة من الأخطاء، لكن هذه خطيئة كبرى أخرى ارتكبها المبعوث الدولي الإبراهيمي عندما تدخل في الشأن الداخلي السوري وخرج عن ولايته، لأن بيان جنيف الصادر في 30 حزيران 2012 لم يتحدث عن الانتخابات الرئاسية في سوريا. الشأن الانتخابي الانتخابات الرئاسية في سوريا هي شأن سيادي داخلي يتعلق بسوريا وبالشعب السوري وبالدستور السوري. الوسيط لا يتدخل في شأن سيادي لأي دولة من الدول. وهنا ارتكب الإبراهيمي أيضا الخطأ الكبير بتدخله في مسألة الانتخابات، وهي ليست من ولايته، وأعتقد أنه كان يلمح إلى ارتكابه هذا الخطأ.
من رفضهم للانتخابات.
الدول النافذة في مجلس الأمن والتي تساعد المجموعات المسلحة والإرهابية في سوريا، طبعا زائد الدول بعض الدول العربية وبعض الدول الإقليمية، هذه المجموعة من الدول لديها خطة سياسية جيوبوليتيكية تتعلق بتغيير الأوضاع في سوريا بالقوة، فلها مصلحة، هذه الدول لها مصلحة في خلق فراغ في سوريا يتم الاستفادة منه على أساس أن الفراغ يؤدي حكما إلى اعتبار سوريا دولة فاشلة. هم يريدون أن يعطوا الانطباع بوجود فراغ سياسي في سوريا باعتبار أن مهلة ولاية الرئيس انتهت ولم يتم انتخاب رئيس آخر. إذن ما هو الأمر الذي سيحصل؟ سيحصل فراغ سياسي. الفراغ السياسي سيساعد أولئك تلك القوى التي تتدخل في الشأن السوري للزعم بأن هناك فراغ سياسي، والفراغ السياسي سيفسر على أن سوريا أضحت دولة فاشلة. هذه هي الخطة التي كانوا يسيرون عليها، ولكن الشعب السوري قرر مصيره بنفسه وستجري الأمور بشكل مختلف تماما. Yes, please.
Russian Ambassador Vitaly Churkin just announced that they tabled a draft resolution in support of local ceasefires, as was reached in Homs. My question is, are you engaged in any talks to reach any new ceasefires in any zones of conflict?
Yes, the Syrian government is deeply involved with regard to this process. Yes, we have encouraged all kind of national reconciliation, and the process is going on. It succeeded in not only in Homs, by the way. It succeeded in the countryside of Damascus, many places. It succeeded in Hama, and it succeeded in Dar'a in the south, and in Aleppo in the north. Mu'addamiyah is in the countryside of Damascus. This is what I was referring to, including Al-Mu'addamiyah, of course. Yeah.
Can you say a little more about the reconciliation? Is that with the people? There's a reconciliation group. Are they helping, or is this, you know, who is working with this? Is this
the government, the notables in the areas where there are armed groups, and the some armed groups who decided to surrender and gave up their weapons. So it's a whole process. It takes some time, but it has succeeded all the way down till now. I mean, it's a very successful program, sponsored by the government. And every day, by the way, you don't hear about it. Every day, hundreds of people surrender and give themselves up to the government, and they are not prosecuted. There is a kind of a process agreed upon by the government as well as by the notables in some areas, so that those who surrender follow a special process of reconversion of these elements into the civilian life, and that's it. And that makes miracles. This is what this Russian ambassador was referring to, actually, and he is fully right. He is fully right to commend and to encourage this initiative, because many people are not, they were manipulated by the foreign interference, the petrodollars money, the political war, the media terrorist campaign. They were manipulated somehow. Now, after 3 years of the crisis, they open up their eyes and they know that something was wrong in their behavior. So it's by thousands of fighters who are surrendering themselves now to the government.
One publication here quoted the Secretary General as saying that he no longer speaks to President Assad, that he only speaks through Mr. Brahimi. Is that, one, is it true? And two, what do you think of it?
It's true that our president doesn't respond to his calls. This is true, yeah. And this is unfortunate, actually, because we drew his kind attention to the fact that he should, you know, he should act as the highest diplomat in the world, as we say. And a diplomat shouldn't also make public statements on the president of a member state in this organization. However, he said what he said, and as you know, a Secretary General calls on his counterparts, ministers, but when he wants to call to talk to a president, he asks for a call. So the president, either he accepts or he doesn't accept. I mean, the party who decides whether he will respond or not is the highest rank of the two parties. It's unfortunate. He's Secretary General. He shouldn't avoid his duties. He should talk to our minister. He should talk to our president. He has to. He has the duty of doing so.
The ICC referral. There's some. I've taken a look at it, but it seems that the intent is to carve out the Golan Heights, for example, so there can be no referral of Israel. Carve out non-member states. What do you think? I mean, I'm assuming you're against the referral, but what do you think of the way that it's designed?
Well, this is, I mean, there is a very important part of your question, which is relates to the Israeli element into this equation. Part of the reasons why Washington is supporting the so-called, what they describe as moderate opposition, the terrorist groups they are supporting, is that this so-called armed opposition is linked to Israel. So this linkage between some elements of the armed terrorist groups and Israel is encouraging Washington to sponsor these groups. This is one of the reasons. The other reason, and it's not a secret anymore, is that Israel is helping the terrorist groups on the separation line, and the DPKO is not reacting to this, although it is a very alarming and dangerous development taking place on the separation line. We drew the kind of attention of the Secretary General and his undersecretary for peacekeeping operations many times on this, and there has been no reaction so far. Israel is treating the wounded of the terrorists in the Israeli hospitals. The Prime Minister of Israel is paying public visits to these wounded guys, and Israel is praising these elements. And not only that, Israel has, sponsored, trained, and hosted the new chair of the new president of what they call Syrian Free Army, the new colonel, whatever. So he was in Israel for 10 months, treated by the Israelis and sponsored and trained and et cetera, debriefed. And then they appointed him as a so-called new whatever. So Israel is deeply involved, and still no reaction. No reaction from the Secretary General, no reaction from his undersecretary with this very alarming development. Thank you so much. Please.
On a separate issue on Syria, the chemical weapons. Do you have any progress to getting to the site which was blocked by armed groups in near Damascus?
No, not yet. Thank you.